the assassination is going to take place on this old-fashioned steam engine going down somewhere in Jamaica. I didn't know how much room they had. I don't know how much room they have. It's like something out of The Perils of Pauline from the 1920s. And then there's a bridge involved, like in the River Kwai, and then you've got Felix Leiter, who works for Pinkerton's, seconded back to help Bond pretend. So Felix Leiter, the CIA, former CIA agent, gets seconded back. It seems they can call them back whenever they need them in the CIA, off the reserved list, and he's pretending that he's an assistant manager in this hotel. Well, so the manager and the assistant manager are both on Bond's side. Very strange hiring practices by the villains, don't you think? It was all very, very neatly tied up. So you get that. You get the character played by Britt Ekland is a character that's been in a couple of, at least this one, but I think a couple of the Bond books. Goodnight, I think it might just be Mary Goodnight. And she really is an assistant from MI6. She's not a villain as a Bond girl at all. And there's also a part where word for word in this movie, she describes the standard issue uniforms if they're working in the tropics for British liaisons or something like this. It's really quite funny. And the buttons are down the back. That was very significant for Bond, it seemed. So you've got a book that has a man with a golden gun, very, very creaky plot, and then you've got a movie where they decide they drop the first part because it doesn't fit in with the way the movies, you know, the chronology of the movies. So they change the whole beginning of that and have some kind of an assassination attempt at Scaramanga's lair. So you've got that going on, and in the movie Scaramanga is living in that place I told you. He's not an American anymore. He still has three nipples. That's a very big part of the book in the movie. So, and he's got the different kind of gun, but he is trying to kill Bond. So he's, you know, that seems to be part of what he wanted to do. And then he's got a henchman played by the famous little person, Hervé Vichois, something like that, who was on that American TV show from the 70s, Fantasy Island. Scaramanga doesn't have any need for that. He doesn't have a henchman. He just has criminal associates in the book. And then he also has a beautiful Maud Adams as sort of a mistress, intermediary to pick up assignments and things like this from this casino drop-off, and I don't know if it's Hong Kong or Macau, and all of this. So they've added one thing after another. They kept piling it on in this movie. It is one of my least favorite Bond movies because I don't think any of it makes any sense, and I think it was really cheapened when they used American Motors cars. They did. There's no Fords. They usually have Fords. They all, you know, they have the Aston Martins and things like that. No, they've got a couple of American Motors cars. Bond's driving one when he's chasing Scaramanga through the streets. Scaramanga's got one who then he converts into a flying car by putting wings on it. So you've got that, which really made no sense either. And then you've got that idiot deputy or sheriff from Live and Let Die, the comic relief, seems to be sightseeing in Asia with his wife, and so he's in it for half an hour basically just being stupid. And it's just, I just don't think it holds together. I just think it's very, very clunky. It's not cohesive at all. It you know, there's obviously some good set pieces in it, but using American Motors cars, just, I'm sorry, didn't work. And they might have made some good cars, but they weren't the right cars for Asia. talk about product placement. It was really blatant, too, with the sign behind them at the dealership. And then, of course, they don't exist anymore. They were taken over by Chrysler a few decades ago. What else happened in it? There's a big showdown in the movie, and it has something to do with getting a device called the Solex, I think. Not the Rolex, the Solex. And it has something to do with solar power. So it's 40 years old. The movie's 40 years old, but the theme about energy and using the sun and all that is very, very contemporary, oddly enough. But none of that's in the book. There was no big plot in the book. It was just that land deal and trying to fleece some people and kill some people. That's what it was. And Scaramanga was a sadist. He wasn't suave. Like Christopher Lee is. Christopher Lee made a very good villain. So they improved upon the book in a way, but the book wasn't very good to begin with. And they're very, very different items. Anyway, I think that's about all I can say. I think that's all I'm going to say. Anyway, Michael from Red Chair Diaries. And I'll see you around the tube. Oh, that's the last. I have finished reading the Bond novels. They don't exist. They're gone. I'm not going to start reading all of the ones written by other people. I just read the Fleming books. Okay? I mean, if I choose to read another one, there's no movies made from them. I just read Octopussy today on a bus that I took to town and back when Ted and I went in so I could have a few drinks with a friend. And that's 39 pages. Long, and it certainly has nothing to do with the movie. Anyway, listen, that's Michael from Red Chair Diaries. I'll see you around the tube.